Welcome to the course on game theory in the autumn 2020 at the University of Mannheim. This is the fifth and last video of week four. So we are in theorem 312, a long theorem on the geometry of the sets of Nash equilibria of mixed extensions of finite games. And before I had introduced some notations, and I had said some generalities about pure best reply sets and some pre-images in the sets of strategy combinations of the other players of some possible pure best reply sets. So now in this video, I will talk about theorem 312D that treats the case of a player who has only two pure strategies. And then I will talk about example 313. So here is part D of theorem 312. Here it's supposed that player I has only two pure strategies. And then with the coefficients kappa I and lambda I, j, his utility function has the shape as you see it above. It has vi of g has two summands, kappa I of g minus I, which is constant from the point of view of player I, and lambda I1 of g minus I times gamma I1. So if we care about Nash equilibria, from that point of view, gamma minus I is fixed, and this term is a constant, and this is a constant, and player I can only influence the last part. The last part is his choice, which he has to choose which mixed strategy combination, the strategy he wants to take, and here is the choice, it's just the choice of the coefficient gamma I1 because it determines gamma I2 and his mixed strategy because he has only two pure strategies. So here you see his space of mixed strategies downstairs, it's this interval here. We have the pure strategy SI1 here and the pure strategy SI2 here. And gamma I1 can run between 0 and 1, it's some value between 0 and 1. So now, what are his best pure replies and what are his best mixed replies if some gamma minus I is fixed? So suppose some gamma minus I, some strategy combination, mixed strategy combination of the other players is fixed. Then we have here a number kappa I of g minus I, which is irrelevant. And we have here a number lambda I1 of g minus I, which is important. So if lambda I1 of g minus I is bigger than zero, then the only mixed best reply of player one is that one which chooses gamma I1 equal to 1. So that's, you see it here. The only best reply is here, gamma I1 equal to 1. And also his only pure best reply is SI1 here, SI1. So if lambda I1 of g minus I is equal to 0, then his utility is constant, it's always equal to kappa I of g minus I, no matter which mixed strategy he chooses. So then all his mixed strategies are best replies, and gamma I1 can be chosen arbitrarily. So then the set of best replies, mixed best replies, is all his strategy space. And the pure best replies are both of them, SI2 and SI1. If lambda I1 of g minus I is smaller than 0, then he should choose gamma I1 equal to 0 to get the best utility, the largest utility. So then the only mixed best reply is SI2. And also the only pure best reply is SI2. So that is the statement of this part D of the theorem. And that is rather basic, and there's nothing to prove. It's obvious from the discussion. Here. So now we turn to example 313. Example 313 treats simultaneously, all finite two-player games where both players have only two pure strategies. So in that case, the utility matrix consists of four entries, which are pairs of real numbers, the left one for player one, the right one for player two, and these numbers I call U, I, J, K. So the utility of player one can be calculated. And here I've wrote something, but it's a bit short. I start with some first formula. So here, now this formula in the first two lines, here it starts. That starts with a matrix. So we have the four utility values for player one. And then the coefficients, gamma 1 1, gamma 2 1, gamma 1 1, gamma 2 2, gamma 1 2, gamma 2 1, gamma 1 2, gamma 2 2. So this is the utility of player 1. But now one can, simplify it, not really simplify it, but change it. I can here replace gamma 2 1 by 1 minus gamma 2 1. And also here, gamma 2 1, I can replace it by 1 minus gamma 2 1. No, gamma 2 1 is fixed, I'm sorry. I should say it correctly. Here gamma 2 2. Oops. Gamma 2 2 is replaced here by 1 minus gamma 2 1. And also here, gamma 2 2 is replaced by 1 minus gamma 2 1. And gamma 1 2 here. And here also, it is replaced by 1 minus gamma 1 1. So this gives me then the second line, and that's the line where I started in my manuscript. And then we can go on to the third line. We can then take out the part which doesn't depend on gamma 1 I. So here in the first square bracket, here you see the part which comes from the 1 here, and then from this part. And in the second square bracket, you see here both parts. This part with gamma 1, 1, and this part with minus gamma 1, 1. And they are put together here. Yeah, and that part gives us this coefficient lambda 2, 1. And the other part here gives us this coefficient kappa 1 of G2, which is usually irrelevant. So that's the way how we can calculate these coefficients kappa 1 and lambda 2 1 if if both players have only two pure strategies. So here is the result again, but I added one line at the top in the calculation. And now V2 can be calculated in exactly the same way. One just has to exchange the roles of player 1 and player 2. And you see here upstairs, and if you compare now this part here with this part, you see that here one has to replace all the indices. U1, U1, 2 is replaced by U2, 2, 1, and U1, 2, 1 replaced by U2, 1, 2. So now why is this useful? What does it tell us? So in this coefficient lambda 1 1 of G2 is important for the first reply map of player 1. So and that is a fine linear function in gamma 2 1, this coefficient. So you see it here. I mean, here is some linear term. And here's some constant term in gamma 2 1. So it is an affine linear function in gamma 2 1. And the first coefficient is now, I give it a name, lambda 1, 1, 0. And the second coefficient, I give it a name, lambda 1, 1, 1. So you can, we try to put it with colors somewhere. Maybe this is good. So this part here is this. And this part here is this part. Now this goes. I'm sorry, I'm in the wrong picture here. Here, it's the correct way. So these are the coefficients here. So it's a fine linear. And vice versa, the coefficient lambda 2, 1 is a fine linear in gamma 1, 1. So this is again, this is here is a 1, 0 and 1, 1, not 10 and 11. So and therefore, and because of theorem 312a and b, the graphs of the best reply maps have a very special shape, and they come now. So there are a priori 13 possible shapes, where I have to say, be more careful what I mean by shapes here. But in fact, two triplets of shapes look the same, so there are only 9 different shapes. I will say, explain this now. So we have to discuss now this picture. So in the left upper corner, you see again the set G, which is here a product of interval 0, 1, 0, 1. For each player in his strategies, there is just one coordinate with values between 0 and 1, gamma 1, 1 and gamma 2, 1. And then, yeah, depending now on the sign of lambda 1, 1 of G2, so here this part is important, lambda 1, 1 of G2 is important for the best reply map, and this now can be, of course, be expressed here by such a sum. So if lambda 1, 1 of G2 is bigger than 0, then the only best reply is the pure strategy S11, so this gives, it means that we need the value gamma 1, 1 equal 1. If this value here is equal to 0, then all mixed strategies of player 1 are best replies. And if this value is smaller than 0, then only the pure strategy S12 and value gamma 1 equal 0 is the best reply. So the best reply set of player 1 depends on the status of this value. Lambda 1, 1 of G2. So, but this value depends on gamma 2, 1, which we have here. So now there are different cases, quite many different cases. So first we consider the case where this constant coefficient here is smaller than 0. This gives us several cases. If the other constant here is also smaller 0, then for any value of gamma 2, 1, lambda 1, 1 will be smaller 0. And then we are in this situation here. Then always for any value of gamma 2, 1, which moves here, the only best reply is the pure strategy S12, and that means gamma 1, 1 equals 0. Then we get this graph here. So now if this coefficient lambda 1, 1, 0 is equal to 0 here, then if gamma 2,1 is also equal to 0, then the whole coefficient lambda 1,1 will be equal to 0, and then we have the whole strategy space of player 1 as best reply set. But if gamma 2,1 is bigger than 0, then lambda 1,1 will be smaller 0, and then we are again in the same situation as before, and we have just these points as best reply sets. So here, if gamma 2,1 is 0, lambda 1 is equal to 0, and if gamma 2,1 is bigger 0, then lambda 1,1 is also bigger 0. And then the only best replies are the pure strategies SI2. So next case, suppose that lambda 1,1,0 is bigger 0, but it's smaller than the absolute value of lambda 1,1,1, which is negative. Then for gamma 2,1 equals 0, lambda 1 will be bigger 0. So then the only best reply is here the pure strategy S1,1. And also if you go up, if gamma 2,1 grows, but not too much, lambda 1,1 will stay positive, and the only best reply is S1,1. But at some point, the contributions will cancel for a specific value of gamma 2,1. Lambda 1,1,0 plus lambda 1,1,1 gamma 2,1 will be 0, so lambda 1 will be 0, and then all the strategies of player 1 are best replies. And for even larger values of gamma 2,1, then this term will dominate, and lambda 1,1 will be negative, and then only S1,2 will be best replies. So altogether, we get here as a graph of the best reply set this Z-shaped curve here with three pieces. Now, if lambda 1,1,0 is equal to the absolute value of lambda 1,1,1, which is bigger 0, then for gamma 2,1 smaller 1, the total lambda 1,1 will be positive, and the only best reply will be S1,1 here on the right, and gamma 1,1 equal 1. But for gamma 2,1 equal to 1, lambda 1,1,0 is positive, lambda 1,1 is negative, the absolute values are equal, so they will cancel. So then lambda 1,1 will be equal to 0, and then all strategies of player 1 are best replies. That's the part here. Okay, and finally, if lambda 1,1,0 is bigger than the absolute value of lambda 1,1,1, then for any gamma 2,1 between 0 and 1, lambda 1,1 is bigger 0, so for any value, the only best reply is S1,1, so the strategy with gamma 2,1, with gamma 1,1 bigger 0, so we are here. So this explains the graphs of the first of the best reply sets of player 1 in the first line here. In the second line, that's the special case where the coefficient lambda 1,1,1 is equal to 0, and there we see that it doesn't matter what gamma 2,1 is, because its coefficient is 0 anyway. So there the situation depends only on lambda 1,1,0. If lambda 1,1,0 is smaller 0, then lambda 1,1 is smaller 0, and then only S1,2 is the best reply always for any possible value of gamma 2,1. If the lambda 1,1,0 is bigger 0, then also lambda 1,1 is bigger 0, and then only S1,1 is the best reply for any possible value of gamma 2,1. If lambda 1,1,0 is also 0, then for any gamma 2,1, utility value is equal to 0, and then all strategies are best replies, and we are in this situation here. So in the third line is now analogous to the first line. Suppose now that lambda 1,1,1 is bigger 0. If lambda 1,1,0 is smaller than minus lambda 1,1,1, then lambda 1,1,1 is also always smaller 0. This is dominated by this term. And then the only best reply is S1,2. So gamma 1,2 equals 0, 1,1 equals 0. Here in this situation, lambda 1,1,0 equals minus lambda 1,1,1. We have cancellation if gamma 2,1 is equal to 1, then all strategies are best replies. And if gamma 2,1 is smaller 1, then still Lambda then still the negative value lambda 110 is dominating, and S12 is the only best reply, because then lambda 11 is smaller than 0. Then yeah, the last three terms I will not discuss, it's similar. So we have a priori these 13 cases where we have to be cautious in this case, and in this case, we have in fact a whole one parameter family of cases, because this really depends now on gamma 2-1. So the position of this horizontal part here, one cannot see it. The position of the, neither here, horizontal part really depends on the value of, no, it depends on the value of lambda 110 and lambda compared to lambda 111. So this is not really one case, but it's a one parameter family case, but with the same type. The other cases, the graph looks always exactly, has exactly only one possibility. But here we have, in fact, in this one parameter families, but they have always the same type. But the position of this horizontal part of the graph can be different for different cases. So now this explains the possible shapes of the graph of the best reply map R1. I want to erase all this stuff here. Oops, I didn't want to erase it. Not too late. So, and now the graph of R2 is the transpose or the mirror of the graph of R1 with respect to this axis here. So if we know now the possible shapes for the graph of R1, we also know the possible shapes for the graph of R2. Now the set of Nash equilibria is of course the intersection of these two graphs. We had seen this in theorem, I think, 2. Where was it? In the best reply map, in theorem 216a, I'm not sure. Yeah, that is quite, we haven't seen it. It comes in the theorem, in the big theorem 312, but it's already clear. So the Nash equilibria and the intersections of the two graphs of the two best reply maps. So and now in the next picture, I show you a table with 81 possible shapes. So in the first column here, I have the possible shapes of the graph of R1. And here in the horizontal cases, I have the possible shapes of the graph of R2. R1 and R2. And unfortunately, I was not completely careful. Now I would have preferred if I had made the pictures in this order, maybe going around here. But shortly I didn't. I first went into this I think it went along here in this direction, then I went along here, and afterwards then I took this special cases here and here. Yeah. So first I took the more complicated cases here in the highest line, then the lowest line, and then these two extra simpler cases, and at the top the case in the middle. So I'm sorry, the other order would have been better, but it works also like this. So in the first column, I have the graphs of the best reply map R1 for player 1. In the first horizontal line, I have the graphs of the best reply map for player 2. And then the set of Nash equilibria is always the intersection of these two graphs. And you see here then 81 shapes coming from all possible intersections. For example, if I pick this shape here, and then this shape here, when I come to this shape here. It's just the intersection. So, and now it's quite an impressive picture. It tells us precisely for what, how the sets of Nash equilibria look like for all possible two-player games where each of the two players has only two strategies. This is a rather special case, but it's an important case. So the majority of the examples which we have seen, the majority of the examples which were usually considered in game theory are of this type. So Prisoner's Dilemma, Battle of the Sexes, Lambert-Lyon examples, they are all of this type. Of course not Scissors Stone Paper. There we have three strategies for each player. So and what do we see here? We see that the set of Nash equilibria has at most three components. It has one or two or three components. And it might be the whole space of strategy combinations. If not, each component has dimension 0 or 1. And so the zero dimension components are of course just points. And we have at most one dimension component. So we have either one point or two components where one is a point and the other is also a point, or two components where one is a point and the other is a line or half line, but as far as away as possible. So for example, this is here, this is typical, this example. Here we have one point and here we have a part of a line, but it starts at the opposite corner. And if we now go to the picture to the left, if this line extends now in this direction of the lower right corner, if it arrives there, then it connects with the point and we have this curve with one component with two pieces, with two vertical pieces, two orthogonal pieces. So again, if we have one component, it might be a point, or it might be one-dimensional, then either it is a piece of one line, or it consists of two complete lines on the boundary, or it consists of three pieces, one somewhere in the interior and the others parts of the boundary, so that is Z-shaped. If you have two components, one is a point and the other might be a point in the opposite corner, or it might be a line which starts in the opposite corner and goes not to the next corner, but stops before. Yeah, and that's it. And if you have three components, they are just three points. Two are in two opposite corners, and the third one is somewhere in the interior of the space G. So in this example here, we have three components. And the third one is not necessarily in the middle of the picture. It is somewhere in the interior of the set of mixed strategies. So if I have now here, for example here, something Z-shaped, sorry. Like this, which goes to like this. And the other part here goes here, then the point will be somewhere there. It's then not in the middle. Definitely not. So we can move it here. We can move it around. Depends then on the position of the horizontal vertical part here and the horizontal part here. So there are two parameters in this case. The third point, for the position of the third point, we have two continuous parameters, but it must always be in the interior of this space of mixed strategies. So then, now in the last remarks, I say something about this. So the set of Nash equilibria might have components of different dimensions, namely dimension 0 and dimension 1. And the intersection of a boundary line of this square G with a set of Nash equilibria can only be empty, or an endpoint, or a connected part which contains one or both endpoints. And the whole intersection with the whole boundary can have yeah, can have one or two components. And the intersection of the set of Nash equilibria with the interior of this square has one of the following five shapes, which are given here. So either the whole interior, or one horizontal line from one from the left to the right boundary, or a vertical line from the upper to the lower boundary, or a single point in the interior, or empty set. So we never have several points, single points, several distinct points in the interior. And we have also not a half line or a line and additional point in the interior. So it's, what we have is it's quite restrictive. We do not have so many choices. And yeah, in some sense, I want still to understand better what arises and why it arises. Of course, we have a complete table, but I would like to have more conceptual arguments and a more conceptual description of the possibilities, which I might then generalize to cases with more pure strategies. But I will not do it in this course on game theory, but it's also some research project. So this is the end of this video. In the next video, I will explain the proof, the theorems 312 F and G and the proofs, and afterwards we come then to examples 314 and 315. Thank you very much for listening.